So right now, we're going to be taking a look at different ways to set up your trolling spread. Now, first off, we're just going to take a look at what I'd use as a typical striped marlin spread. And that is taking into the fact that striped marlin don't feed like blue or black marlin. They tap stuff around a little bit. So I've got a selection of lures here. Generally speaking, with all my trolling spreads, if I'm running four lures, I run my bigger lures in close, smaller lures out on the riggers. So you go, Sam, I'll give you that one there. BJ, that one there. If you want to clip them onto these rigger rods, we'll run them out. Whenever you're setting your spread, you want to run out your rigger lures first. Now, there's a simple reason for that. If you've got your flat lines out, and then you've got to run your rigger lures past them, you can get tangled. So we'll get the rigger lures out, then we'll get the flat lines set out, and we'll have a look at the pattern and just how we're setting them. Okay, so this lure we've got here is quite a slender bait fish profile, like a soury. Because it's got an angled face, I've got that whipping on there, and I'm making sure that that hook is keeled in. The hook's been touched up and sharpened, and just sort of place it into the water so everything sort of sits nice. Before the lure gets too far away, I like to sit it there and make sure it's running well. So this rod here is for my long rigger. It's back far enough. Now, to put it into the clip, I'm going to use a rubber band. You can use Dacron loops, which are really nice spliced onto your line, but I've found these guys here, which are like a UV rubber band. They're really easy to apply onto your line, and they don't wear out like your traditional rubber bands. And to attach, the simple case of just wrapping it around your main line. And you're wrapping back towards the rod tip, keeping every wrap nice and tight. You want to do at least 10 wraps, and you take the top end through the bottom end, and that creates our loop that's going to be going into our black slip on the outrigger. Now, before we put that out, I'm just going to be testing that black slip for releasing. At the moment, last time I was out fishing, I had a big bait in there, so I've got that set hard. I actually want that for striped marlin to really pop open nice and easy. I actually can tolerate a few accidental trip outs throughout the course of the day, just so long as I know that that's going to open at the slightest touch of a marlin's bill. And I'll explain that theory later as soon as I've got this up in the rigger. Now that I've got my clip up at the top of the rigger, I'm just going to set my drag. Now, when I'm fishing with striped marlin, I like to fish with an extremely light drag. So I've just got that there, maybe at only 2 kilos. Just more or less just enough to stop the line overrunning. I'm going to flick the clicker on, and I'm just going to leave just a wee drop back. So a nice slack loop of line. Now, the theory is, with the striped marlin fishing, quite often the old striped marlin will come up and it's going to give its prey a bit of a whack. And when it whacks it, if it was a fish, it's going to expect it to stop. And then it's going to open its mouth, flare its gills, and it's going to induction feed. It's going to suck the food in. That's what I'm trying to let it do with this lure. There's two trains of thought. There's drag and snag, hard drag, two hooks. When the fish gives it a whack, you snag him in the face. This is a slightly different theory, where it comes up and whacks it. That lure's going to stall when it pops out of the clip. It's going to grab it. The light drag's going to allow it to turn. Now, when we get a bite, 2 or 3 seconds is heaps for the fish to have been able to turn and start swimming away. I'm going to then increase the drag lever up to about 5 or 6 kilos of drag. That's going to be plenty to hook the fish, clear the gear, and we're fishing. Now let's just take a look at how we're going to set up our flat lines. Now for our flat line lure, hook's nice and sharp, jammed it in so it's keeled. I'm just making sure that hook's pointing directly up. That lure can go in the water. So we've already got our short lure out there. This one's going to go back just a little bit further to be our long flat. And I'm going to set the drag at just enough to stop that lure bleeding out. In fact, I don't even mind it bleeding out a tiny bit. And every half hour or so, I just pull in a little bit of line. That way I know when that marlin grabs the lure, it's going to be able to turn easily. Because if it can grab a hold of the lure and turn, wait there, let me get a lure. Now, imagine that lure is going along like so. There's a hard drag, the marlin grabs it. Yes, we can hook up, okay, by snagging him. But we've got quite a small area that we're actually able to hook. Now, if this marlin can grab it and it can turn easily, then the drag increases, we've got a whole side of the fish and we're pulling back the other way. A lot more chance to be able to get that hook to roll into position. That's the theory that I'm going with, and well, this helped me catch over 1,000 striped marlin. Okay, so what we've ended up here with our long side and our short side is a diamond known as the Hawaiian diamond. So the lures are all staggered, they're at different distances from the boat, and they're less likely to tangle when we're making turns. Now, for a fifth rod, you'll see I've got the Talika 25 here. I've got this hooked up to a live mackerel. Now, should we have a marlin turn up in our spread that doesn't want to eat? Well, we can wind the lure in and we can get the bait out. Now, it's not ideal trying to bait and switch when you've got hooks in. This is really a trolling pattern, but that's just there as a backup. We're going to look closely at how you would properly bait a switch a little bit later on.